So I'm very excited to be here, and I'm just going to tell you a little bit about just a couple stories that actually got me to standing in front of you today. So this is why I'm here. This is a guy that was one of those just collisions in life, right? A sliding door. And his name is Tempt. And Tempt, in the 80s and 90s, was one of the foremost graffiti artists in Los Angeles. And he came back from a run one day, and he said, "Dad, my legs are tingling." And that was the onset of ALS, or Lou Gehrig's disease. ALS has gotten a lot of popularity recently with the Ice Bucket Challenge, which has been incredible. And I met his father and brother and found out that he was the way that he was communicating was through a piece of paper. He'd been laying in a bed for 7-8 years and not communicating at all, just with a piece of paper. And they run their hand along a piece of paper, and when they get to a letter, he blinks. And they would write the letter down. And then they would start again, right? Finger along paper, get to a letter, blink, write the letter down. So the process of communication was horrifically, painfully slow. And for me, I was like, that's not right. That's not right that that should be a situation where that someone's communicating in that manner. And so I have a process, and I met his brother and father, and they told me this, and I said, that's not right, we gotta change that. So my process is that you commit, and then you figure out how the hell you're gonna pull it off. And it gets you into some trouble, but it gets you into some good things too. And so what I decided to do is I brought this team of people together. I flew them in from all over the world, and we created this device. It's a device called the iWriter, and it's basically a pair of glasses from the Venice Beach Boardwalk. I live in Venice Beach, so $8 pair of glasses. A wire that you duct tape to the side, and you put a web camera on the front of it. And what it does is it basically uses your pupil as the tip of the pencil. And so we created some code that uses your eye and the pupil as the tip, and then you blink, and that kind of engages and disengages the pencil on the piece of paper, if you will. So we went through and we made this thing, and this is actually what the final prototype looked like. And we went to his hospital room, and we set up a projector, and we went down into the parking lot beneath the hospital and said, all right, draw. And then he drew, and the projector outside projected on the side of another building, and he drew again for the first time in 7 years. And it was a party, and we were high-fiving with his family and my friends, and everybody was there, and it was an incredible experience. And then 2 weeks later, but we did it just because it was a goof, right? We just did it because it was fun and we wanted to do it and we thought it needed to be done. But he sent me this about a week later, and it was, that was the first time I'd drawn anything for 7 years. I feel like I'd been held underwater and someone finally reached down and pulled my head up so I could take a breath. And he sent that, and I'm like, all right, I don't know what we did or how we did it, but we have to keep doing this. This is something that we have to keep doing. So I've always been in technology. I've worked in animation and design and visual effects, so I'm always around some kind of technology. And so I believe that technology can do some amazing things, but what we proved with the iWriter is that technology can be used for the sake of humanity. And what I believe is that every piece of technology that you have, that you own, a cell phone, a computer, things like that, it does the thing that it's designed to do, but it can do something else as well. So we took glasses and sunglasses that were designed to do one thing, we turned it into something else. We took a web camera that was designed to do one thing, and we turned it into something else, and it accomplished a fundamental social need. And that's how I see technology. How do you break it? How do you hack it? How do you modify it? How do you change it in some way, and then make it do something significant? So that brought in this whole just almost obsession about the concept of impossible as well. Because it was impossible for him to draw, but it wasn't that hard for us to do it. And what I realized is that there's nothing in this world, not a single thing, that wasn't impossible at one point. Name something. Name anything that wasn't impossible at one point. The obvious, screens, rooms, architecture. Let's take a step back, woven clothes. Let's take a step back even further, walking upright, depending on your religious beliefs. So everything was impossible at one particular time. And so as I'm thinking about this, one of the things I thought about was one of your countrymen, this guy, 1954, in May. Never in all of recorded history had anyone broke the 4-minute mile. Bannister comes, breaks the 4-minute mile. Within, I think, 75 days, that 4-minute mile that had never been broken ever before in the history of time, that's a really, really long time, the history of time, right? Recorded history. It's broken 3 more times. He breaks it, some other guy breaks it, and then Bannister breaks it again. So impossible really wasn't about impossible. Impossible seemed to be more about permission, right? Someone does something, and then it automatically gives you permission to do it. So July 11th, 2013, I go out to dinner with a friend of mine, and he tells me about this guy. This guy's named Dr. Tom Catena. And Dr. Tom is this amazing doctor, and he's telling about he lives in the Nuba Mountains, and he serves these people, and he's just this amazing guy. So I go home, and I, you know, do what you do after a couple glasses of wine. You go home, you get a glass of water, everybody's in bed, I open up the computer, and I go onto the web, and I start researching this guy. And this guy is, he's based in between Sudan and South Sudan in this contested area called the Nuba Mountains in South Kordofan. And he is the only doctor with a 1,500-mile radius. He does everything. He delivers babies. He gives you inoculations. He takes out your appendix. He draws blood. He does everything. He's the only guy there, right? And he's got some support staff. And the story goes on, and it talks about how one of the things that he absolutely hates is he hates the fact that he has to do amputations in this area because it's a war-torn area. And there was one story in particular about this boy named Daniel. And Daniel was a young boy who was out tending his goats, his family's goats. And Sudan, on a regular basis, they fly over the public areas and they roll these 55-gallon drums filled of jet fuel and shrapnel out of the back. And when they hit, they do that. They make a big hole and they spray shrapnel everywhere. So the good thing, if there is such a good thing about a bomb like that, is that if you're down when the bomb goes, it goes over the top of you and you're good to go, right? You wait for the dust to settle and you're back to doing whatever you're doing. Daniel was in a situation where there's no foxhole anywhere. So he went and he wrapped his arms around a tree. And when the bomb went off, the tree protected his body, but it blew his arms off. And I'm reading this, remember, 11 o'clock at night, and I'm reading this thing. I'm sitting at my kitchen table, and the article went on to say that when he woke up and realized that he had lost both of his arms, now keep in mind, it's hard enough to live in Sudan and in sub-Saharan Africa with both of your arms and both of your legs. It's hard enough, and now he has no arms. And when he woke up, he said, "If I could have died, I would have. I'm now going to be such a burden to my family." And I'm sitting at my kitchen table, and I'm looking down the hallway, and down at the end of the hallway are these knuckleheads. And they're sleeping. And I could not imagine them waking up from anything and saying, "I wish I could die. I'm going to be such a pain in the ass to Dad now." That was that moment that got me in the gut. So that was the commit thing for me. So I'm like, all right, I got to do something. Not exactly sure what, but I got to do something. So my process is also, as I said, with the iWriter, I love to surround myself with people who make me feel stupid, right? If you're the dumbest guy in the room, you win. Why? Because you're learning. The smartest guy, he's probably bored talking to the dumb guy, right? So I see it like in my game console, in my chest, in my head, my power is going up and his is going down. So I surround myself with these kinds of people. And so we brought them all together. We move all of our stuff out of the living room and we just start hacking away and we start looking at different things to do. And we try 3D printing and we try cutting PVC and we try balsa wood. And a couple months earlier, I had written a story about a carpenter in South Africa named Richard Van Aas. And Richard Van Aas had accidentally cut his fingers off. He went to the hospital and said, "I'd like to get a prosthetic." And they said, "That'll be $15,000, please." And he said, "I'm a carpenter. I don't have $15,000. And they said, "Well, come back when you do." And he said, "That's ridiculous. I'll be right back." And he went and played around with a thing called a RoboHand, and he made some 3D printed fingers for himself that became functional. He started sharing that with people. So he was one of the smart guys that I invited into this group. And when we failed miserably in our first weekend, the Maker Weekend, he sent me an email and said, "Listen, I I don't think you should go to Sudan. And I'm being very nice because he doesn't use nice words. He said, you're effing crazy. Don't go. He said, you are a 6'6" bald target that's going to be walking around Sudan. Don't go. And he started listing off all the things that are going to happen to me. But at the end of the email, he said, but if I can't convince you otherwise, swing through Johannesburg on your way to Sudan and I'll teach you a thing or two. So my ticket was bought. I hopped a plane, went through, stayed at Richard's house, slept 3 hours a night for 6 days, and he went through and taught me kind of what he knew, and taught me kind of the nuances of making prosthetics, the nuances of 3D printing, and how to fix a 3D printer when it breaks. Keep in mind, at this point, I'd never 3D printed anything, and I certainly had never figured out how to do something with a prosthetic. So we went, and he was incredibly gracious and taught me, and after eating his food and sleeping on his floor, stinking up his room from not showering because we were in the shed and working the entire time, I bid farewell to his family and hopped on a plane. I flew to Juba, capital of Sudan, and from Juba I flew to Yida, the refugee camp. Landed in Yida. That was not the plane that I was on. But every runway I landed on throughout Sudan, I land on four, that was on the side of the runway. So there's some sick joke that they like to play on the foreigners, that's what you see when you land. So I landed in Yida, I didn't know this, but Yida was called by the UN as the most challenging refugee camp in the world. And our plan was to land, go immediately to go pick up Daniel, and meet him for the first time, and I was kind of nervous. It was like, this whole thing is about you, and I'm coming to meet you. But we were going to meet, collect everything, put it in the truck, and then drive 10 hours across the border, under the cover of night, because we had to cross over the border from South Sudan and Sudan and get to Dr. Tom, where we were going to just start making arms and make an arm for Daniel and teach everybody how to do this thing. So we packed up and we got ready to go and the trucks are all ready. There was a problem, though. The problem was the ceasefire ended while I was in the plane from Johannesburg to Sudan. So we're packed up and ready to go and we're starting to pull out and the SPLA come in and they say, I'm sorry, you can't go. And I respond like a Hollywood producer would respond. Maybe you don't understand. We're shooting. We're gonna go do this. I've got some printers, and this is our plan. And we're going to go. And he said, maybe you don't understand. We have guns. I said, all right, you win. So luckily, an NGO took us under their wing and said, hey, we've got a shed. If you want to start up and start working over here. And we said, yeah, let's do it, you know. Life gives you lemons, make lemonade. So we went over and we set up in the shed and we just started making and hacking and building things and started working on the cast arm that was going to be the extension from the stump and started working with the fit. And I'm nervous. You know the saying, measure twice, cut once? I'm measuring 7 times and cutting once because I'm like, this is Daniel. This is my first arm I'm making for him. So we went through this whole process of doing this. And there's a saying that they told me prior to getting there. Richard told me and then some of the people in the camp told me that TIA, if you're to TIA. I'm an American. I didn't heard TIA before. And I'm an optimist. And I was like, TIA, this is Africa. Come on. No. It's going to be fine. Right. The electricity wasn't right. The tools wouldn't work. It was so hot. Does anyone know how a 3D printer works? You have a spool of plastic, and it's hard, and it goes through. The best way to say it is like think of a pastry chef squeezing frosting out. And it squeezes out the bottom, and that's how the frosting kind of gets out. Well, that's how it works. It goes through something heated first. It was so hot that the plastic was melting before it even got into the 3D printer. So we had to print at night. So we set our prints off, went to bed, came back the next day. Prehistoric moths had lodged themselves into my printer. So that jammed the printer. So it was one thing after another that was kept, you know, jamming things up. But this is what I was looking at every day. I was looking at Daniel. So November 11th, which is 3 months to the day after I went out to dinner and first found about Dr. Tom, this happened. Thank you.
Daniel was 14 when the bomb took his arms. I read the article about him and had to help. I came to Sudan with 3D printers, laptop, spools of plastic, and the goal to build Daniel an arm.
You ready? And then Daniel fed himself for the first time in 2 years. But it's never about just one person.
You just double click.
This is the hand, 90 degrees. If we could teach the locals to do it themselves, the project could live long after we left. And it did. Thank you. Thanks. Thank you, thank you. That doesn't go into my 15 minutes. So what we're up to at Not Impossible Labs is around this concept of help one, help many. The story of Daniel was a story about one person. But the thing is if I ask you guys, hey, let's go cure poverty, let's go cure hunger, who's in that? Who wants to do that? You'd be like, yeah, sure. But if I say, let's go feed Jim, he's hungry outside, and we'll get him a sandwich, you're like, okay, let's do it. We can do something. So our whole philosophy is that helping one person is what leads to helping many people. And if you then do something and you give it away for free, you create something and give it away for free, that has incredible power. So the question that I would ask everybody tonight is, who is your one? Who is your one that can help many people? And in the context of Non-Impossible Labs, who is your Daniel? Thank you, guys.